and you live in a body. Your body is the container of your soul and your spirit. Is that? You completely, that may your whole spirit, whole soul, put it that way, all body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. That tells you that the moment your soul is sick, it affects your body. Now listen to me, when your spirit is healthy, it affects your soul and your body. Now listen to me, the moment you have your spirit man, your spirit man becomes alive when you are saved. Do I have the slide? Do I have a slide?
No.
Oh, you didn't get it?
No.
Oh, I sent it to you. You didn't get it? No problems. I will explain it. You have a spirit, you have a soul, you live in a body. When you are born again, it's your spirit man that is born again. But a believer that is born again can be sick in the body, right? Can be sick in the soul, right? I want to quickly explain soulish sickness. When you are sick in your soul, it affects your spirit. It affects your body. What are the roots? What are the root causes of sickness in the soul? Don't forget, we're anchoring the scriptures on, I pray that your whole spirit, soul, and body, when we have sickness in our soul, most of the time, what brings sicknesses to our soul is our family background. Where we came from. Some of us came from a very, very dysfunctional home where daddies are not there, mommies are not there. Even when they are there, they are not there emotionally with us. Most of the time, they are not even there physically. All of the time, some of us, we find ourselves in a home front that though our parents are there physically, but they go through a lot of conflicts. Fights, actions, reactions. So you feel rejected. You feel abandoned. You feel that something is wrong with me. You feel that I am not happy. That's why when you look at children, they come to you and they say they are not happy. That's why you see them sad. Some of them are sad. Some of them don't concentrate in school. Some don't want to read. Some don't want to do anything. All they want to do is to just do something. Probably, they start watching pornography. Some start to drink. Some start to smoke. Sometimes to do some things that they know something is telling them what I'm doing is not good, but they cannot help it. Because they were sick in their soul. Sickness of the soul makes someone to sit down and you want to die. You don't want to live. You don't believe in yourself. You don't accept yourself. When people tell you, wow, you are doing well, say, what am I doing? I'm not doing anything. I'm okay. We don't want to accept compliments. When somebody goes and show you love, you are asking, why is he showing me love? What does he have in mind? He gave you the only one that he has. And when he gives you one person like that, that he lost so much, that he, when he carried the sin, nobody could look at it. Even God did not look. Yeah, your father may not love you. Your mother may not love you. Everybody around you may show you so much hostility and no care. But I have a good news for you. He loves you.
Amen.
He cares for you.
Amen.
He wants you to be healthy. Now listen, when people are not healthy in their soul, they bring out something that is not good to their world. Why? Because you use your emotions, that's in the area of your soul, to and I'm changing my face. It's my emotions.
Yes.
If I come around and I get angry at everybody, it's my emotions.
Mm-hmm.
If I smile and I'm playing, how are you? Everybody fine? What are you doing? I love Jesus. It's my emotions.
That's right.
So when I do, when I'm healthy emotionally, I bring it out to other people to see.
Mm-hmm.
And they keep loving me. They keep caring for me. When I go out there and I'm hostile and I do something that is not showing that I'm happy emotionally, it affects everybody around me.
That's right.
Am I saying the truth?
Oh, yes.
Now, like I said, before we became born again, before we accepted Jesus, we have a lot of loads. I thought they did the PowerPoint. I brought some graphics for you to see. So many things happen to us in our homes, in our settings. Somebody will come, some cousins will come, the aunties will come. Some of us, it's not that somebody said something. Maybe you lost someone that you love. Maybe somebody walked out of your life. All those pains are sitting in your soul. They are resting there. Words are powerful. Maybe somebody had told you are good for nothing, you are just a fool, you are not intelligent, you are a dummy, you're this, you're that. It affects you.
Yes.
Can I give you an example of someone in the Bible? He was a prince. His name was Mephibosheth. He was a prince. But because there was an accident, there was a war, and the nurse was trying to protect and run away, and he fell from the nurse, and he was crippled both feet. He lost it on his legs. And he had to be dropped somewhere. I'm just trying to make it simple for you. He was dropped somewhere in the place of no pastor. He was just dropped somewhere. And one day, I told you he loves you. I told you the king is interested in you. I told you you are loved with an everlasting love. I told you there's a covenant of life over your life. David just said one day, is there anything again that I want to do to bring back this boy into the palace? And he began to ask everybody. He began to ask questions. He was asking people. And somebody was in the palace. Naturally speaking, you don't have somebody in the old regime to be in the new regime. Mephibosheth was related to the king, to David, to Saul and Jonathan, right?
Yes.
But that person that was talking with the king was in the palace when Saul was in the palace. He was supposed to have left because David was coming. But God strategically positioned somebody there, able to connect him. And pray for somebody today that God will give you divine connection.
Yes.
Strategically, somebody just Ziba was not necessary in that place, but he had a mission.
Amen.
And the Bible says, the king said, Is there anybody in the house of Saul? Listen to me. If a natural king is ready. Lord, the one that went to the grave, the one that died for you, the one that went to the lower part of the earth to set the captivity captive. What about him that loves you and died for you? David did not die for anybody, but he still believes that there's a need for someone to be rewarded because of the covenant. Do you know that we are in the covenant?
Yes.
Our relationship with Jesus is a covenant relationship. Somebody say, you don't understand, I'm weak. I'm not strong. I have weaknesses. Excuse me. God is not looking at your weaknesses. He's looking at Jesus.
Yes.
He never sees our weaknesses. He saw the one that died for us. He does not see that you are frail. You are not good. You are bad. No, 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 no. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Do I have the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus in the house? That's who you are. Am I still making sense somewhere? You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. If a man can want to say, let me help someone for the sake of my friend, how much more Jesus that died for us? We are the friend of God. I am a friend of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And the Bible says it was so amazingly true. The Bible says that Ziba said, well, he has only one son. He's in Lodebar. He's crippled both feet. You know why the guy said that? He felt that, do you know, naturally speaking, anybody that has any physical form of deformity does not show up in the palace. So he wanted to disqualify him. There are people in your life, I'm hearing God in the Holy Ghost, there are people hearing me today that people are just trying to disqualify you. Listen to me, when they disqualify you, when God qualifies you, nobody can disqualify you. They cannot disqualify you. Are you getting what I'm saying? They're just trying to say, you don't deserve it. It doesn't have to be her. It doesn't have to be him. It doesn't have to be she. It doesn't have to be him. It doesn't matter. When God is ready to do what he wants to do, he will do it. The Bible says, who is it that will speak and it will come to pass? If God has not commanded it, when God is ready to help a man, he will go all the way. You know what King David said? He said, go and get him for me. Forget the way he looks. Forget the way, whether he's crippled both feet, whether he does not have head. But you know something, where I'm going, because the spirit, soul, and body issue is so important. I don't know why he called himself a dead dog. But he was telling, he does not believe that good will come. I don't know who God has sent me to today, but good is coming. I said good is coming. I said good days are coming. I said better days are coming. I said better days are coming. I'm not repeating myself, I'm emphasizing my point. I said better days are coming. You know what God told me? I hear God clearly. He said, I'm going to bring better days. I hear God in the Holy Ghost. He said, a new day is coming. I don't know who I'm sent to, but a new day is coming.
Amen.
It's going to be a dawning of a new day.
Amen.
And you know, when the king sent for Mephibosheth, the king was too surprised. He said, Mephibosheth? He was surprised. He was dazed. He said, what happened? The guy could not talk. Just stayed there. And a book of remembrance was open. I hear God in the Holy Ghost. The book of remembrance will be open for you. He just remembered. And he said, I don't want to bother about the way you look. I want to bother about the covenant that I've made with my friend. If a man can respond to the covenant, can stay by his words. The Bible says forever, oh Lord, the word of God is settled. It's settled forever. If man can quickly respond to the word, as I've made a promise, that tells us something. Wherever you find yourself, whatever damage has been done to your soul, done to your mind, done to your body, done to your emotions, done to your feelings, said about you, talked about you, talk you down, frustrate you, make you feel stupid. The king said, I don't mind. The reason why I came to call for you is because I have something in mind. And what I have in mind is restoration. What I have in mind is restoration. Somebody is hearing me today. God is going to restore. He will restore the years the locusts have eaten. He will restore the years the caterpillars have eaten. He will restore the years the canker ones and the palmer ones have eaten. I hear God in the Holy Ghost. I will restore.
Amen.
I will restore. Amen. This is your season of restoration. I may not be sent to everybody.
Yes.
But I came as a voice of God.
Amen.
That you will make references to this moment.
Amen.
That God said, I will restore.
Amen.
I hear God in the Holy Ghost where you have been shamed. The Lord said to me, there are some of you here, there are points of your shame. He said, they will come back to the point of your praise.
Hallelujah.
It will come back to be the point of your celebration. It will come back to be the point of your recovery. It will be a place where you will know that this is the point that God have met with me and has changed my story. I hear God in the Holy Ghost. God is changing. To sing a new song. Do you know that when the king sent for Mephibosheth and he sat on the king's table, you know how kings eat? Kings don't eat anyhow. They eat, they have different, it's more than a buffet. Are you getting what I'm saying? They sat together and I'm sure you know, Mephibosheth does not know how to handle such. You know, sometimes when God turned against the captivity of Zion, it's like a dream. He didn't know how to eat in the palace. I'm sure he will sit down in the table and begin to watch how they pick their cutlery. He will sit and be looking. You know the way you learn something without not wanting anybody to know. You are just, okay, this is how they do it. This is how they do it. Okay, okay. The fork is on the left. The knife is on the left. The fork is on the right. Okay, that's how they drink. Of course. And please look at this. Somebody had called him a dead dog. Somebody has called him a crippled man. Somebody have insulted him. But when the time came, and when the season of recovery came, nobody could remember whatever they have said about him. I have come to declare to someone that in the next few hours from now, few moments from now, nobody will be able to say what they said about you before you came to church. That will be your testimony in the name of Jesus. That will be your testimony. I'm not trying to make you feel good. I'm telling you, thus saith the Lord.
Yes.
Am I communicating something?
Yes.
I'm just telling you, this is what God is saying.
Yes.
Because he said it. He said, I want the God of peace himself to sanctify you completely. Your life should be balanced.
Yes.
Do I have somebody in the house that your amen will thunder?
Amen.
After this encounter, your life will be balanced.
Amen.
Balanced life.
Yes.
Balanced life.
Amen.
It will not be upside down anymore. You won't be happy in this area and you are sad in this area.
Amen.
I stand in the grace of God today to declare
Amen.
And decree over your life
Amen.
That you will start living a balanced
Amen.
Life. A life that will give praise to Jesus.
Amen.
Because that is the will of God.
Amen.
When Mephibosheth sat there, everybody that had hated him, the news went around the town. I don't know who God is sending me to. The news of your goodness.
Hallelujah.
The news of your breakthrough.
Hallelujah.
The news of your favor.
Hallelujah.
And you know, sometimes, somehow, when people don't expect you to make it, and you started making it, the news will begin to go around. People will begin to talk. They are talking not because they wanted to talk. They are talking in gossip. Do you understand what I'm talking about? They are taking out of gossip. But that gossip became a good news. Yet, whosoever I've said to today, I believe in the spirit of the living God. Your season of good news has come.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Strange favor.
Amen.
Strange favor.
Hallelujah.
I hear God in the Holy Ghost. Mysterious favor.
Hallelujah.
Some of you have been doing some things over and over again. This is a season of switch.
Amen.
It's a season of switch.
Amen.
I said, switch will happen.
Amen.
Somebody that has not known, have not noticed you before, they begin to notice you.
Amen.
Ah, your name will begin to flitter
Amen.
By the Spirit of the Living
Amen.
God. Do you know that everybody in town would have said it? Is it true? Is it not true? It's not possible.
Yeah.
How can it be? How can Mephibosheth go to the palace? He doesn't deserve the palace. It's a lie. Some people will say, let us come and see. They will start looking.
Hallelujah.
Is it true? Somebody is hearing me today. They come close to you, they will know that truly God has done you well.
Amen.
I said they will know that God has done you good.
Amen.
Whatever it is that you have been battling with, do you know that Mephibosheth never thought it was going to happen? But the Bible says when the Lord turned against the captivity of Zion, whatever you did not think will ever happen, what you did not think would ever be imagined. I speak in the grace of God. Where you never thought help will come, help will come from that place. Somebody somewhere will link you with somebody somehow that you never thought it would happen. It will happen in the name of Jesus. And there is nothing the devil can do. They can't envy you. Because somebody who does not know your story cannot envy your glory. Yes. Do you understand what I'm saying? God, somebody that does not know where you are coming from, they will just look at you and there's nothing they can do about it. Whether he's carrying his wheelchair to the palace and to the dining table and he's walking around the palace. Do you know? Same day, he became a CEO, a crippled man, a dead dog, a man called Mephibosheth. You know the meaning of a Mephibosheth? The one that destroys shame. Are you listening to me? He would have been asking himself, I am destined to destroy shame. This is shame. Somebody is hearing me. You are going through the cycles of shame. It is going to change. It is changing already. He will ask himself, this name they have called me, this name they named me, it does not look like what is going on in my life. But that is story. Did you hear what I just said? That is story. When God talked again the captivity of Zion, it will always look like a dream. You will beat yourself and say, wake up, wake up, wake up. Are you sure I'm in the palace? Wake up, wake up, wake up. When people are calling and they are coming around saying, it is God. This God has done it for me. Somebody's story will soon change. Amen. You will open your mouth and tell your word, God has done it for me. For me, he has done me well. He has done me good. And everybody that has mocked you, they will have no choice. Amen. That to start talking good about you. Amen. They start lobbying around you. They will start trying to associate with you. I came to this altar today to make a declaration. The Bible said by a prophet God delivered Israel. By a prophet they are preserved. I came to release on this altar today grace for outstanding favor. The only thing that helped Mephibosheth was that he came when he was sent for. He never bothered about what people have said. He never bothered about what he's feeling about himself. He doesn't care how he felt when they were calling him names in the neighborhood. But he took himself to the king. He followed the process of recovery. He allowed himself to say, well, let me try it out. And let me be honest with you. God is powerful. He's able to do exceedingly abundantly, far above what we can ask or think. Don't let the devil lie to you that it's not possible. Tell yourself it is possible. My life is possible. My destiny is possible. My ministry is possible. My future is possible. The life of my children are possible. Whatever looks impossible are possible. Whatever look impossible are possible. I am a child of possibility. God makes all things work together for good for me. Because I'm called according to his purpose. Because I'm a child of the living God. A lion does not pray to roar. He roars naturally.
Yes.
You are a child of the King of Kings. Greatness flows in your bloodline.
Amen.
Success flows in your bloodline.
Amen.
Favor flows in your bloodline. I speak today by the Spirit of the living God. The grace that took Mephibosheth from Lodebar in the house of Makkah, a place of loneliness and shame, will bring you to a place of honor by the power in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, you are not saying amen. I said by the power in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He never thought he would come out. He had taken to F-A-T-E, not faith, but faith. He has accepted. The Lord said to me, some of you have accepted your level here. I'm pushing you to another level.
Amen.
You can't accept this faith. You are moving to another level.
Amen.
If a man can respond to the covenant, how much more? The Bible says that every handwriting that was written against us, which was contrary to us, Jesus took it out of the way. He nailed it to the cross.
Amen.
If the blood of bull and goat can make so much. On the point of your shame.
Yes.
The point of your embarrassment.
Amen.
The point of your stagnancy, the point of your going around the circle, the point of your embarrassment, the point of your abandonment. The blood of Jesus speaks to those roots in the name of Jesus. When David went to the valley of Elah, they thought it was fun. They did not know that God changes times and seasons. That was the beginning of a new day for David. He went out to be an errand boy, but God honored him and gave him an opportunity to become the killer of Goliath. And from that junction, just one sleep, I don't know who God is sending me to today, just one sleep took him from the place of being a sheep rearer, just a mere man. He became the shepherd. He became the killer of Goliath. I speak to someone today, this day of the year, this hour, this moment, this minute, help, mysterious help is coming your way.
Amen.
Do you know the amazing thing is the attitude? And I'm going to close with that. Mephibosheth put up an attitude. The king said, I should come. Let me go. My father, 1 Samuel 17. My father said, I should go and take care of my brothers in the battlefront. Let me go. In Luke chapter 5, Peter told all night, and Jesus says, can I use your boat? He said, use it. The grace to respond positively to good people, good attitude,
yes,
God will give you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Do you know that all these people have mentioned, it was just an attitude.
Yes.
They just made a decision. Whatever the case may be, the king said, I should come. Let me come. He was not sitting there complaining. Hey, you don't know. Can't you understand? Don't you see what's going on? Shut up. Just obey. Trust and obey.
Yes.
There is no other way to be happy in Jesus.
Amen.
But to trust and obey.
Amen.
When we walk in the light of his word, what a glory is shed on our way. When you obey him, he honors you.
Amen.
Just respond. Oh, David would have reacted and said, Dad, am I an errand boy? Why are you doing this to me? When they wanted to anoint everybody, you didn't call me. Now they want to have their backling. You know, you don't know the stuff I'm made of. I've killed lion, I've killed bear. The Bible says he left the sheep with the sheep keepers and he went in obedience. He just obeyed. Whatever is making you to disobey God, for you to miss your blessing, today I shut it down in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
I give you power to obey,
amen,
power to respond, power to say yes, Lord. Despite the inconveniences, say yes, Lord. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. If Peter has said, hey, I've been struggling, toiled all night, I have not caught anything. Please, Jesus, mind your business. Let me mind my business. He would have missed his prophetic moment.
Yes.
He would have missed the angels that works with Jesus for breakthrough. I speak over somebody today. You will not have a wrong attitude.
Amen.
What made him to be able to receive a net-breaking miracle was to say yes. From the bottom of his heart. Say, you can have it. I've been washing it. It's not working. Take it. And he handed it over to Jesus. And the Bible says, I don't know how many days Jesus was preaching. He sat down and began to listen. He said, well, you are using my book. Just do whatever you want to do. Do whatever you want to do. Just do whatever you want to do. Suddenly, when Jesus finished, he turned to Peter and said, Peter, what's going on? Stand up and put your net on the right side. Jesus, you don't understand. I'm skillful. I'm a professional. I understand the mastery of fishing. It doesn't work like that. Do you understand what I'm saying? I understand how it works. It doesn't work like this. This is the midday. It can't work. You just remember that this one has been using my boat. He has been preaching. And people have been blessed. Things have been happening. He's the miracle worker. His name is Yahweh. He's an unchangeable changer. He's a right of, hey, okay, Jesus. I will do it. Nevertheless, at your word, the Bible says he let down the net. Jesus said net. He did net. He was still limited because he has issues in his soul. because he has pain, because things have been said to him that has limited him. Even his job was telling him it can't be possible again. Limited. But the Bible says, the moment he dropped the net, mysteriously, fishes, different types began to float into his net. Mysteriously, where were the fishes over the days that he has been toiling? Where were the fishes in the night? I speak to someone today that you will hold this word to heart. The supernatural that mixed with the natural that brings an explosion. Let it happen to you in the name of Jesus. In the area of your business, let it happen. I said, in the area of your business, let it happen.
Amen.
As far as your life is concerned, everything that will give you joy, give you peace, give you rest, give you serenity, give you happiness, let it begin to happen in the name of Jesus. Let the angels that is assigned to me in assignment begin to come. I don't know what happened that day when the fishes began to rush into the net. They were so full that the nets were breaking. I connect you to the net breaking favor.
Amen.
Net breaking miracles.
Amen.
Net breaking connection.
Amen.
Something you will do that you will look and see, ah, this little thing, how is it becoming big? God will magnify his mercy over your life.
Amen.
Is that not what Lord said? He said, you have magnified your mercy. I pray for somebody today that God will magnify his mercy.
Amen.
Over your life, he will magnify his mercy.
Amen.
Over your destiny, God will magnify his mercy.
Amen.
Over that which you lay your hands to do, God will magnify his mercies in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I heard in my spirit, no more toiling.
Amen.
I don't know who has been toiling, you've been struggling. The Lord said, no more toiling.
Amen.
No more struggling.
Amen.
No more toiling.
Amen.
The season of your celebration has
Amen.
Come. Somebody has been mocking you, they will come and marry with
Amen.
You. Somebody has been looking down on you, they will start looking
Amen.
Up to you. In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Somebody has said, can her God help her? Can his God help him? Let us wait and see. I stand in the grace of God today. They will wait and see.
Amen.
And those who cannot wait, they would have gone before it happened.
Amen.
The Bible said he set a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And he has anointed my my head with oil. And my cup run over. I release a running over grace
Amen.
To each and every one of you today.
Amen.
By the Spirit of the living God. Let this season and this moment of your life be a moment of memorial. Let it be a season of divine connection. Let it be a season of favor and rest. Let somebody somewhere who has never linked up with you before, let them begin to link up with you. And so shall it be. Thank you, precious Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Holy Spirit. The Lord said to me, there are a few people here this morning, you've been struggling. As a matter of fact, you're just covering it up. Just one or two people. The Lord said, I should tell you that help has come.
Amen.
Help has come.
Amen.
Help has come.
Amen.
I said, 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 help has come.
Amen.
I'm not repeating myself. I'm emphasizing, I'm prophesying as I'm commanded, help has come.
Amen.
Somebody's help has come. From the rising of the sun to the going down, help has come.
Amen.
From the courtesies you cannot expect, help has come.
Amen.
The God said to me, I'm clearing that debt. Help has come.
Amen.
Help has come.
Amen.
Favor is coming.
Amen.
Somebody somewhere will just help you. You will not know how it will happen.
Amen.
I didn't know how fishes got into that net.
Amen.
I didn't know how the crippled man can be eaten in the palace. I did not know how the roots, the Moabite can be come to the genealogy of Jesus. I didn't know one woman that was barren for 10 years to become the mother of children. I don't know what Rahab the harlot is looking for in the genealogy of Jesus. The God of miracle, we miraculously begin to connect you.
Amen.
We begin to help you. We begin to guide you.
Amen.
And so shall it be.
Amen.
Precious Lord.
Amen.
Give you praise.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Father, I thank you for the entrance of your word that has brought light. I pray that this word will do us good.
Amen.
Everyone that have received this word today, let them know that you have come to visit them.
Amen.
Thank you, precious Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Let's put our